we want to just mention a couple of our books. Praise God that God's given us the privilege to write, and one of them is How to Flow in the Supernatural. Praise God, it's a little book, but I'll tell you what, you can learn how to flow, how to release the power. Glory to God, and it's just what Burning Bush has taught me. And so put it down in a book so you can learn about that, how to flow in the supernatural, and then knowing God. I tell you, there's something happens to a person that gets to know God. Amen. They'll act different, they'll live different, they'll walk different. Everything will be different in life once you know God. Hallelujah. And it takes a long time to get to know God. I believe after we're in heaven a million years, we're going to still find out about God. That's how awesome He is. Man, and so in our limited way, praise God, we get to know God. Hallelujah, by His Word, by the power of the Holy Spirit, and by experience. Man, you get to know God. Hallelujah. And aren't you glad tonight that God's in a good mood? Glory to God that God's not angry anymore. He took all His own anger out on His own Son. Boy, that's a proven fact. Glory to God. These people that say, man, God's going to get this country. That's a wrong message. He's not angry anymore. He's saying, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Man, I'll tell you what qualifies us for salvation is our sin. If you wouldn't have sinned, Jesus wouldn't have had to die. I've had people say, would you receive Jesus? No, I sin too much. No, praise God, that's what gets you in. Isn't that awesome we have a God like that? Hallelujah. Anybody want one of these books? Yes! You get it all the time.
Could you turn the lights on, Nancy?
Oh, nice try. Praise God.
Do you have another one?
Well.
Over there.
Boy, I'll tell you what, that's the kind of guys that get it. Hallelujah. I found out that's the kind of people that get it from the Holy Ghost, too. I'll tell you, we have people in meetings that are spectators and participators. Some people just come to spectate. But boy, don't be a spectator. This is your week to receive. Praise God. God's doing something. Boy, just go for it. Hallelujah. Like that gown guy. Well, Bonnie and I get to minister together tonight. Hallelujah.
So since Dennis told a redhead joke this morning, I'll tell a blonde joke tonight. There was this is my only joke, so. There was this blonde gal driving a sports car, speeding down the highway, and a blonde patrol police woman stopped her and said, "Let me see your driver's license." Well, the blonde sports car driver fumbled through her purse, looking, and she finally said, "Could you tell me what the driver's license looks like?" And the blonde policewoman, I have a hard time saying cop. You know, that's what my generation, I guess. The blonde cop.
Come on. Be free.
Thank you. Thank you. Said, "Well, it's small, it's square, and it has your picture on it." So the blonde driver looked in her purse some more and found her mirror, looked at it, and said to the cop, "Oh, here it is." And the blonde cop looked at that mirror and said, "Oh, I didn't realize you were a cop, too. You can go on now."
I'll tell you one. This guy's having dinner with his blonde girlfriend. And she's eating. She kind of got some food on and said, "Hey, you got a little piece of food on your cheek." And she went like this. And he said, "No, the other side cheek." She goes.
So we are
going
to.
You want to hear another one?
No, I don't. No.
Just kidding.
He came back from the Navajo Nation and was telling us some he told, and they had such double meanings that, and he didn't realize what the double meanings were.
You don't
know about
that.
It's true. Lee and I had to educate him on what he was telling them. So, anyway.
You know what, you know what you call a Navajo vegetarian?
Oh, that one's okay.
Poor hunter. You know, wherever you go, you learn these things.
Our message tonight is free to be who you always wanted
praise
to be.
Praise God, that
yes.
gives me freedom.
And we were talking about this, and all of the speakers have been saying pretty much the same thing in their own language, whether it be South African or Missourian or whatever language they speak in. But they have talked about, and we've talked about, the fact that in the body of Christ, there seems to be a great problem that so many believers who know Jesus Christ do not live in victory. They're always struggling. They're always disappointed, depressed, whatever. It just seems to be an epidemic. Looking into the future or living in the past and having the past drag along with them in their everyday life, it seems hard for Christians today to live a victorious life. And so we started asking ourselves, why is this such an epidemic in the body of Christ? And we came up with a couple of things that we think about it. There are many Christians who have a poor me attitude, and they are always putting themselves down and saying what a bad life they have and so forth. And we think that a lot of that type of thing that goes on in the body of Christ is people trying to draw attention to themselves, and so they have to say all these negative things about themselves and magnify themselves. Because when you do that, when you focus on something like that, you magnify yourself rather than magnifying God and Jesus and what they've accomplished for us.
Arthur was saying this morning about self-centeredness. It's all about self, bringing the attention to yourself.
And then we talked about the spiritual gymnastics that go on in the body of Christ, how there are groups of people who say we have to pray more and fast more. And someone talked this morning about more commitment and more this and do that. And that you have to try harder, pray harder, cry out to God more. And all of these things that make you dissatisfied because you're never reaching what you're supposed to be reaching, never feeling like you are anyway, and always thinking that you're not measuring up to what you want to be.
And you see, when God created human beings, he didn't want an army, he had angels to do that. He wanted a family. Praise God. So he wanted a family, so he created human beings, not human doings. And it's easy to become a human doing. Got to do this, got to do that. And there's so many people doing things, and doing is not bad. But if it's for the wrong reason, trying to get acceptance from God, which Jesus has already accomplished, then that is self-centeredness.
And then you think about the praying harder and how there are whole movements trying to get an open heaven by what they are doing. And you know, that just is so much striving and work. And I always think, okay, guys, you go ahead and do it. I'll get in on it. But I don't have the energy to put forth all of that effort to make sure the heaven is open when I think it's always open. I mean, good grief, God lives in me. And so
You know, you hear Christians say, man, I don't know if my prayers got past the ceiling.
Yeah.
They don't have to. That's why you bow your head and pray. There's where he's at. Praise God. He doesn't have to go through the ceiling. Hallelujah. You're traveling with the power team. The Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and a host of angels. What are you worried about? Man, we are bloated. God's given us everything that pertains to life and to godliness.
So we see a large segment of the body of Christ that needs to know the truth and understand the truth, as we were talking about this morning. You shall know the truth and it will set you free. Just having it inside of you or memorizing scripture will not set you free. You have to know the gospel truth, and that is what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross. That's the truth that we have to know in order to be who we always wanted to be.
I saw this bumper sticker in Denver. It said, "Ignorance is expensive." Man, that is a powerful statement. What you don't know, that's where the enemy will get you. All he can use is deception. Once you know the Word of God, you can walk like Jesus walked on the face of this earth. And that's the way Jesus wants us to walk. Amen. Praise God. That's the truth that sets us free.
But as we were talking, too, I told you how just in the last couple days I've had the revelation that we always say we have to line things up with the Word, we have to know the Word. Well, that's not quite true, because when you say that, we're meaning all of this, and we actually, because of what Jesus did on the cross, have to line ourselves up with the gospel, which is what he accomplished. You could line yourself up with all kinds of bad stuff in here, meaning it's for our good, and it's for our learning, and for us to know from, but it's not the truth that sets us free. The truth that sets us free came when Jesus went to the cross and died and accomplished what he did and rose from the grave. That's the truth that we need to know in order to be set free.
It's like Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. That's Old Testament. That's all. That's before Jesus died. And even the books, it's the Acts of the disciples. It's not the discussions of the disciples. It's the Acts of the disciples. And so we saw what the disciples did in Acts, and then Romans started, and that's where you start getting the message. The message is in Romans, where it starts. Praise God, where you can see what the new covenant is.
Yes.
It's between law and grace. Law and grace. And Paul is the one that wrote this. And you got to remember who taught Paul. It wasn't anybody on this earth. It was Jesus himself. And Jesus was so particular about this message that he had to teach Paul himself so that he'd keep the message straight. And it took Paul a long time to get the message. 13 years and all that stuff out in the desert, all this stuff, but he had the message right.
And like we were saying earlier about the glory of God filling the earth, glory meaning God's view and opinion. How many believers don't yet know God's view and opinion of them? And they're taking a religious view and opinion and putting themselves down and feeling unworthy and so forth. We've been watching some of the video clips from the movie about Martin Luther. And in the 1500s, when he was a Catholic monk, he reformed everything that was going on in the church world because he started reading the New Covenant, started finding out what Jesus accomplished for him, started realizing what God thought about him. So let's look at this clip from the movie Luther and see what he then began to preach to the people in his Catholic church.
Terrible. Unforgiving. That's how I saw God. Punishing us in this life, committing us to purgatory after death, sentencing sinners to burn in hell for all eternity. But I was wrong. Those who see God as angry do not see him rightly, but look upon a curtain as if a dark storm cloud has been drawn across his face. If we truly believe that Christ is our Savior, then we have a God of love And to see God in faith is to look upon his friendly heart. So when the devil throws your sins in your face and declares that you deserve death and hell, tell him this. I admit that I deserve death and hell. What of it? For I know one who suffered and made satisfaction in my behalf. His name is Jesus Christ, Son of God. Where he is, there I shall be also.
When you see this man, you got to see this. Once he got that revelation, what he just was saying, it changed his life. And the pain and the suffering he had to go through, you can imagine, they had never heard this message before. Man, and here God used this guy that was willing to put his life on the line for the message. And he did it. Praise God. So, man, this is a good news message. We
get
to preach.
God wants us to experience his love, to know it and to experience it on a daily basis. Like we said, do you wake up every morning and experience the pleasure of God? That is being free to be who God wants you to be. Experience his love, his satisfaction, his pleasure with you. When we don't, here's what happens, and this is what happens to Christians. If you'd like to turn to Ephesians 4, verse 17. Ephesians 4, 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind. And that's non-believers, the futility of their minds. But yet, it happens to believers also when we don't know the truth of what Jesus accomplished. Having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardening of their heart. Ignorance is expensive, as you say. And it alienates us from the life of God. When we have our understanding darkened and we have mind games going on in our head about what God thinks and does he love us, does he not love us, and about ourselves and how he sees us, is he angry, whatever, then we have futility in our minds. We're alienated from the life of God because the life of God is inside of us, but when we have mind games playing, we can't experience it. Who, being past feeling, have given themselves over to licentiousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness, but you have not so learned Christ. That's not how we've learned about Christ, praise God. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. As we know, the law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And then it says that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in righteousness and true holiness. Hallelujah.
Isn't that wonderful? God's telling us how to put off and put on. Man, we put it off, but it's so easy to put it back on. I don't know if you could hear different kinds of teaching. It's just amazing how easy it is. Well, you remember how full of joy you were when you first got saved? Remember that? Man, you were so excited that God loves you and everything. And then what happened? You went to church. And at church, you found out what you had to do to be right with God when you were already right with God. That's what happened to us. And guess what we started doing? Performing for God. The devil got us into performance. And we started basing our relationship to the Father on how well we did. Isn't that right? It's not what we do. It's what he already has done and did for us. That's the finished gospel.
And so we have to repent of our wrong thinking. And repent means change your mind, take a 180-degree turn. And I read this in Arthur's newsletter. Repent is not from wrongdoings or sins. And how many of you knew that before? We always have been taught you repent of your sins. You confess every sin, every day, every minute. You know, some of you would be so busy, you couldn't get out of bed. You just have to lay there and repent. But repent is not from wrongdoings or sins, but from our attempts to serve God under legalism and law. That's what the Bible talks about when it's referring to repentance. To stop attempting to serve God under legalism or law, but serve Him by accepting the finished work of Christ as your righteousness. So repent, change your mind, turn around, and think a different way and go a different direction.
That's even what Jesus was saying in John 16. Just comes to me down about the 10th, 11th verse, somewhere in there, where the Holy Spirit's job is He comes to convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. And then Jesus went on to explain it, of that He convicts us. How did we get born again? He convicted us that we were sinners. Of righteousness, His job now, the Holy Spirit's job now, is convicting us that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
He's not convicting us that we're sinners anymore. He's convicting us that we're righteous. Man, even the Holy Ghost is on our side. What a deal.
And so, putting on and putting off, it says here, we put off the old man, put on the new man. And how do we do that? Is it hard? Is it difficult? It means reckon it as so. Reckon it as already having been done. That's how you put on. That's how you put off. It's already done for you by Jesus Christ. And so we say, like it says in Romans 6:11, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we experience putting on and putting off just by believing that it has been done in the new birth and our resurrection into new life. And we want to just illustrate a little bit about this. And we're going to go to the scripture in Galatians 2:20. Galatians 2:20. So many people, Christians, live being hurt by past things in their life, past experiences, and as if it's something that is current with them today. Maybe the father abused them, your father abused you. As I've said before, my husband should be a basket case the way his father abused him. But he chose to put that off and not bring it into his life with the finished work of Christ. He didn't choose to dwell on it and try to bring it up all the time and try to get healed from it all the time, but he considered it was in the past. It's done, it's taken care of because he's a new creature.
That's right. I made up my mind when I was a young boy. I was going to have a good time in life. Praise God, I was going to go to heaven laughing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's a choice. You have a choice. And guess what? You can have every kind of circumstance come against you. But even joy is a choice. You can choose joy. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. Hallelujah. And He's happy all the time.
And that Ephesians 4:24 verse said, the new man is created according to God in righteousness and true holiness. Reckon it as being so. Put that on. Focus on that. Magnify that in your life. Think about that. I am created in righteousness and true holiness. It's a fact. I don't have to strive for it. I don't have to try to earn it. I don't have to go to 10,000 prayer meetings to try to get it. I don't have to pray for an open heaven so it can come down and consume me. I have it because of what Jesus accomplished. So Galatians 2:20. First, verse 19, Paul said, "For I through the law died to the law, that I might live to God." How many of you still live under law? How many Christians live under law? We're to die to the law. And somebody may be saying, but Jesus said, "I didn't come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it." Well, he did fulfill it in his life, and then on the cross he destroyed it, and he took it far away so that we never again have to operate in our relationship with God through laws, rules, and regulations. So, Galatians 2:20, want to read that? Let's just read this first verse.
I have been crucified with Christ.
So what happens when you're crucified? You die? Yeah, you die. Okay, Dave's going to die now to illustrate that he has been crucified with Christ.
Okay, go up on the top one,
please.
Nope, this is good enough.
You're not going to lay down? Dead men don't sit up like that.
Yeah, they do. Some die like this.
Okay. And he, when someone dies, you cover them with a cloth so that, I guess it's a sign of, why did we do that?
You have to see them.
So we don't have to see them anymore? Okay.
Hey, I'm going to come alive here shortly.
Yeah, that's true, but now you're dead.
Okay, dead.
Okay, he's crucified with Christ. He's dead. And now we have to decide what died with him. When he died with Jesus, the power of sin died over him. The law died to this dead person. The law has no effect on this dead person here, crucified with Christ. The power of sin has no effect on this. What kind of effect would it have? Nothing. The old man, where is it? It's dead. It's dead and gone, crucified with Christ. Death has no dominion. He's already dead. Death has no dominion over him. Self-centeredness. No, he's not thinking about himself. He's crucified with Christ. He's dead to that. Guilt. Do you think this person is feeling guilty? No, he's crucified with Christ. He has no fear of wrath, no fear of judgment. He's crucified with Christ. He has no sense of condemnation. He's crucified with Christ. And then Galatians 2 goes on to say, we've been crucified, and it's no longer I who live, but here comes the new creation, and it's Christ.
Ah!
Christ living in this man.
Wow.
You look good.
So it's no longer you who are living. You were dead. You were buried. And then when you received Jesus, you did receive Jesus, so that resurrection power is in you, and now you're alive, and it's no longer you who are living, but it's Christ who's living in you. And the life that you now live, you live by the faith of the Son of God.
Great.
Who loved you and gave himself for you.
Whoa.
Whoa.
You mean I have to love John?
No, you get to.
I think, keep teaching, I'll just walk like
a new man, a new creation. You're now alive to God, and you're dead to all that other. And you can focus on being alive to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
and all this other stuff. Come over here and teach it to us.
Wow. Listen, this. I can have an intimate relationship with God. Amen. To God's love, forgiveness. I'm alive to the fruit of the Spirit. Grace, favor, peace, righteousness, and inner peace. I have newness of life. Abundant life. Reigning in life. I have victory. Hallelujah. Amen. Boy, listen to this. I'm saved from wrath. Whoa, reconciled, have resurrection power living inside of me. I've been justified. I have lacking nothing, hallelujah. Man, I belong to the family, I'm complete. He's qualified us, delivered us, transferred us to another kingdom.
So you see, when he came alive to God, he was transferred out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. And that's now where he lives and walks and moves, alive to God.
I can walk along here and say, hey, Father, what are we going to do today? Hallelujah. Man, you don't have to think about all that past or anything else. Man, I'm alive and well with you. Glory to God. Isn't this awesome? Amen. You know, when you think about this, in the Old Testament days, the Holy Spirit just came on people. Because there wasn't anybody holy. God couldn't come in them because of the sin. First man, Jesus, walked into the river. And you know what he did? He made it possible for God to put his Spirit in us. How can we prove that? How can we prove that we are now righteous, we're holy in God's sight? How many of you have the Holy Spirit inside of you? Boy, this is proof. Hallelujah. That's proof God sees me holy, righteous. Isn't that awesome? Glory to God. This is what all of creation was looking for. We get to experience it.
So what if you start being tempted to think that your old man is still alive and that sin has power over you and that death has dominion over you? Those are temptations.
Yeah.
What we do with that?
What happens? It's the craziest thing. If you hear the wrong teaching, you'll start putting back the dead man. Pretty soon you're lugging along the dead man. You'd be surprised how many people Jesus has set free, and then they begin to put back this old man.
Relating to God
through
the law.
Start wrapping this thing around him again. Oh, man. It takes...
It's stinky.
It takes work
smells.
To stay free. It does. Man, it's a job to stay free.
Well,
man,
you reckon it so. And you realize that it's no longer you who are living. It's Christ who lives in you. And it can be free and easy.
So let's all reckon it dead. You gonna reckon that old man dead?
Yep.
Praise God.
And so when we say free to be who you always wanted to be, there's nothing you have to do except believe that it's so. Amen. That's what it is, believing that Jesus accomplished it in the finished work on the cross.
Done.
You already are.
See, I say this often. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost from heaven got together in a committee meeting. And they said, if we're going to save these people on earth, we're going to have to do it ourselves. And that's what they did. Praise God. And you see, man, the reason it's so hard for man to accept this plan, we don't have anything to do with it. All we got to do is believe it. Praise God, in believing, you received. Isn't that something? How, you know, I've come to the conclusion, if it's not simple, it's religion. God made it simple. It is so simple, praise God, and so wonderful. Man complicates it. Religion complicates it. Isn't that something? Glory to God. Nancy, you just can't tell her. You got to tell me, too.
So you just keep going.
Got some more.
I just forgot to tell the servers in the kitchen what time we plan to be finished here. So it's too late. Okay, so we'll just keep going. All right, Colossians 1:18.
Oh, man.
Colossians what?
Colossians 1:18. And Jesus is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. And until we reckon ourselves as dead and then alive in Christ, we focus on ourselves, on our past, on our hurts, on our whatever, rather than on Jesus, and he desires to have preeminence and be magnified.
Amen. What's that really mean? Does that mean you're supposed to go around complaining?
No.
Does that mean saying, oh, poor me?
No,
God doesn't get any pleasure of that kind of praying. Praise God, just like I was saying last night, he wants us to walk around saying, I'm blessed. Man, I'm blessed. I have everything that I need, hallelujah. And you get a revelation of this, it'll shorten up your prayers to eternal gratefulness.
When you know he's done everything,
it's
already done for us, then we can be eternally grateful, walk around alive in God, knowing his spirit is leading us and guiding us, and not having to question and say, oh, I wonder if God wants me to do this or do that. You go by what's in your heart, and you do it, and you live that way, and you don't have to be wondering and frustrated and questioning. And we realize that we are now one with God himself.
That's it.
He's in me, I'm in him, and we are one.
So what you're saying, we're free to be the person we always wanted to be.
Right, because we are. Because Jesus made it so, as a new creation, created in righteousness and true holiness. That's you.
Boy. Boy, this is so good you could put a shout in a statue. Glory to God. Whoa. Isn't this awesome? So what Bonnie is saying, if that's true, we can walk around acting like Jesus. And Jesus will get pleasure from that. Praise God. Man, everything you do, every smile you give to somebody, say hallelujah to someone. Oh, man, great day. We're just representing Jesus. You're putting a face on Jesus. And this world needs to see the real face. I think we've entered back into this thing. Will the real Jesus please stand up? I think the real Jesus is standing up. Clearer and clearer and clearer, day by day by day. As more people get this revelation knowledge of what's been done, we can start and do greater things than we've ever seen in our lives.
So if you have a poor self-image, if you don't know your identity, if you don't realize the dignity and worth that you have to realize you can only get it from one source, Christ in you. Focusing on Christ in you, realizing his finished work, that will give you your identity, your self-image, your dignity, and your worth. Turn to Colossians 3.
As you're looking there, Bonnie, I'm just thinking about this, is that... Boy, if we'd see Jesus in every person, Christian, we'd treat each other a lot different, wouldn't we? We'd start honoring each other. Praise God. Instead of letting our old flesh, old man, so to speak, come alive. Man. Boy, I tell you. No, I'm not going to say that either. Go ahead.
Colossians 3, verse 2. Then, if you're having a struggle in your mind with all of this, it says, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth, for you died. And your life is hidden with Christ in God. You're dead. The old you is dead. And now Think about the fact that your life is hidden with Christ in God. You're one. You are one with him. In John, when Jesus said and prayed, Father, I pray that they will be one, just as you and I are one. Many Christians today are still praying for that to happen, and it already has. He accomplished that on the cross. We are one. We are one body. And then in verse 4, when Christ, who is our life is Christ. There is no other life besides Christ in us, living through us. There is no other life. It's an illusion. Anything else is an illusion. It is not reality.
It's true.
When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Christ is our life. Hallelujah.
That's it.
And we are what he's created us to be.
Powerful, isn't it? That's the good news message. Right there. Man, we don't have to struggle or anything. It's all been done. Yeah. We just accept it by faith.
That's right. We reckon it as so.
Yes.
And we walk in this newness of life.
That's good.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Boy, I just hear this song going through me. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased by God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day. Is that pretty much it? Is that pretty much the story? This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all day long. Man, that's it. That's it. You'll see more miracles than you ever seen in your life walking like that. You'll just have divine appointments just rise right up in front of you. Glory to God. You're being obedient to the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit says, hey, witness to that guy, you know, don't let your brain kick in. Boy, you just need to relax. I've had that happen to me so many times like that. For my brain said, oh, he doesn't want to know Jesus, man. He's, oh, man, awesome. Boy, I was talking to Phil over here, and I'm going to say it in a nutshell. Phil goes into the prisons. Phil has Bible schools. Man, I'll tell you what, he represents us in a big way in faith in Australia. He had a company of people with him. He goes in there, talks to this first lady, says, you're the ugliest woman I've ever seen in my life. Ooh, no wonder you're in prison. You're mean. I mean, this people are with, what is Phil saying? Boy, and he got their attention, man. And then he came back and said, that's what the devil's been telling you all your life. That's the devil speaking. Yeah. And he went back and told everyone, you're the most beautiful woman I've ever seen in my life. Got them all saved. That's a Holy Ghost. That's a Holy Ghost. It wasn't getting religious or whatever. Had to go in there like the Holy Ghost said. Isn't that true? Glory to God. If he's just another nominal Christian, they wouldn't have listened to him. Hey, they got his attention. You're the ugliest woman I've ever seen. Hey, how'd it get? But you don't do that without some bars in front of you, you know? No bars? Oh, man. I thought he was talking through the bars. You got more guts than a Texas slaughterhouse. Nice. Well, Bonnie,
so
what do you say?
Would we like to see some pointers that people got from this message?
Yes, let's do that.
Okay.
Let's just wander around.
Right.
Hallelujah. We're going to might come to you. See what you got. I'm going to start off with Diane. One point. Did you get anything?
Jesus fulfilled the law in his life, but he destroyed the law on the cross. That's an awesome point.
That's it. That's good? Mm-hmm. Good, Diane.
Who else would like to say one thing that you got from the message tonight?
Go ahead, Bonnie. I got a gentleman back here.
Two words, I'm free.
Amen. That's right.
Bill?
I loved what you said about the real truth beginning in Acts and how the message of the new covenant began there. And that was awesome in Romans, too. Also.
Praise God. Isn't that good? Not the discussions of the disciples? Yes, Jeannie?
I like what you said. It's work to stay free.
It's work to stay free. Yes. Wisconsin?
Ignorance is expensive.
Praise God.
Over here, John.
I need to leave the dead man staying dead.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, brother.
I like what Bonnie said about the illusion. That's exactly what it is. We walk in an illusion, believing a lie, and not disciplined in lower nature. And you're not going to practice what the Word of God says you're going to do.
That's right. Yeah. We believe the illusion more than the truth.
Who would rather live in an illusion than the truth? Yeah. That's a poor choice. Okay, over here.
That no matter our circumstances, that we can just be joyful in the Lord and that He can work through us and change us and we can just live in happiness because of Him.
Thank you, Becca.
Something really touched my spirit today, and it just clicked. It a lot more, yeah. But basically, I believe that, yeah, Jesus has already perfectly reconciled the whole world. So basically, just believing that, the world will be changed by Jesus Christ being lifted up in my life. So that's it. It's all over. It's all over. So it really is.
Yes, He's reconciled the world, and now the world gets to receive it by faith.
This is Jan.
Each person. Jan?
That was so good, I forgot what I was going to say.
I mean, she was overwhelmed with that.
That's awesome. He just got it. What I wanted to say was that you reminded us again that if we would treat everybody like the Jesus that was in them, we would treat them differently. And we need to be reminded of that. I need to see Jesus in everybody every minute. And that was just awesome.
That's why Paul said, I see no man after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Amen. See, that is the way to live the Christian walk. Boy, and you can start seeing. My eyes might not see the best in every person, but I'll tell you, you start seeing by the Spirit, you'll see Jesus Himself in there. And you'll start treating like they are the sons of God. Kathy?
I'm a walking dead man.
You look good for a walking dead man.
I want to just to mention about Jan. Jan, stand up a moment. She's a new partner in the network. And I want to tell you, we met in 1991 approximately on an airplane flying over the ocean. She and a team were coming from Africa. We and a team were coming from Russia. And we met on that airplane, and now God has connected us here in this network.
And then we're going to Africa.
Yes,
together.
And she's going to Kenya with us in August.
Yes. Glory to God. Isn't God awesome? Yes, this gentleman from England. Glory
Tino.
To God.
Well, I like the blonde jokes, but no, I'm kidding. No, the finished work of Christ, knowing and understanding that is key to us achieving everything that God wants us to achieve and being everything that God wants us to be.
That's right.
I like the part about what, you know, the talk was about becoming the person we always wanted to be. And I really feel like tonight I got the word that when Dave said that about we're traveling with the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost and a company of angels, what more do you want than that? And it's like, wow, I don't have to really become anything now.
Yeah.
He's everything. Yes. I don't have to become anymore. I'm just exhausted from trying to become.
Oh, that's a good word, Sherry. That's what all these things that we were talking about, it brings exhaustion.
Yeah.
And I don't like to be exhausted.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I appreciate the introduction of the third sacrament, which was the dead man with the sheet. Now, I think we should incorporate that into all of our services with baptism and communion, because it was an excellent, excellent, I mean, that's staying with me. Thank you.
There's only one problem with a living sacrifice. We keep trying to crawl off the altar.
And water baptism is when we reckon that we are dead to the old. And so water baptism is an important sacrament so that the whole world and the spirit realm and everyone else sees that you are dead and now you're alive in Christ.
How do I look from the dead?
You look great. Okay, over here. Donna.
I think it's really wonderful that we've been delivered from the kingdom of darkness,
yes,
and translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son, and it's no longer us that lives.
Yeah.
It's Christ that lives in us.
Yes.
That means we're in his kingdom. We're just like him. That means the devil has no power over us. We're free.
That's right. That's right. We're free, and he's already king in our lives because we've made him so.
We are the Church of the Living Dead.
John, are you leaving us?
Deb, did you have something to say? Debbie? Deb Woodmar? You had your hand up, or were you standing up?
Tom Green said exactly what Deb was going to say. Okay.
I thank God that we are living with the power team.
Yes.
Without the power team, we're nothing.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in us. We travel with the power team.
Yes, Rebecca.
Well, when you said that we saw each other as Christ, it reminded me of what the Lord told me. And the Lord told me that each and every one of us is his gift to the world. And he just wanted me,
yes,
to repeat it,
yes,
to everyone.
Yeah.
We're all his gift.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
We are God's gift to the world.
God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and God so loved the world that he gave you to the world.
Whoa, that's really good, Rebecca. Okay.
Diane.
Excuse me.
Since you made me go first and didn't give me a chance to think, and now
okay,
I had a chance to
I
think.
I can see your wheel, darn it.
When you said in Galatians 2:20 that the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God, it's his faith that accomplished it for me. I'm all prayed up because he's all prayed up. He spent all of that time in prayer with the Father, and he lives in me. So I get the benefit of all that he did, the faith of the Son of God who loved me and died for me.
Amen.
See, if he's given us everything, like Diane's saying here, it's not even our faith. It's his faith. It's his gifts. It's his everything.
His life.
And can you see, I believe you're starting getting more confidence in the Holy Spirit, the one who indwells you. See, when you start getting confident, then you're going to start walking like Jesus. That's what he did. He never questioned. He knew the voice of the Father. So do we. We know his voice, so we can walk.
And it's called the exchange life, We have exchanged our old life for his life.
That's it. Mm-hmm. Yes, Dennis?
If I'm dead and he's alive in me and I've got everything that pertains to life and godliness and it's not my faith in his, but it's his faith, would it be easy to get a miracle tonight?
Oh.
Yeah.
Hey. When you get the right message, miracles are no problem. Yes, that's just normal Christianity.
Yeah,
you don't have to sing three songs to get anointed. The Holy Spirit on the inside of you is on go.
Yes.
He's on go all the time. He said to me, if you got guts enough to say it, I can do it.
Yes. Come on.
Amen.
Hey, we ought to be the big blabbermouths, praise God. Open up, just wiggle your lips and see what you're going to say. Hallelujah. Let the Holy Ghost speak. Boy, where your ears have to come around here and say, what?
So why don't you pray for some people?
Yeah. Anybody here need prayer?
And we at this time, though, I would like to request that the following people make their way to the kitchen. Georgie Nelson, Jesse Bloom, Alfia, Mary Vandesteen, Napoleon Dynamite. All the young people in that row, go to the kitchen and help because I know you wrote this. Janice, how do you say your last name, Janice? Huff?
Huff.
Okay. And Chris King. Thank you
Praise
very much.
Praise God. Now who needs...
Young people, Napoleon Dynamite people, go help. Go on. What?
Anybody need something here tonight? I mean, just you, maybe you need a healing or whatever.
Use the mic.
Yeah.
Just one simple comment. I praise God for this. I have never felt so free in my entire life. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Freedom.
Hallelujah.
Boy, yes. That's a good one to end up
Thank
with.
You, God.
Yeah.
Go ahead,
That's
Dennis.
It. That's what it is.
There's somebody here that's been struggling with their eyes. You need a healing in your eyes. There it is. Come on.
Come on, brother. Here's the wild brother.
Yeah.
Come on, sister. Glory to God.
Come on. Thank you, Lord. What's wrong with your eyes?
Well, I have contacts in my eyes. I don't like taking them out at all, really. Yeah. But I just...
You want them healed.
Yeah, like they, I believe that they are healed.
Okay.
But I,
you're receiving.
I yes.
By the way, thank you for these eyes being restored.
Yes,
right
thank you, Father.
God, I call for 2020 vision in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you.
What's wrong with your eyes?
Dry tear ducts.
Dry tear ducts. Blood enough for her cataracts to go away and her tears to start tearing up. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I call and command these cataracts to come off her eyes. I command them to diffuse from these eyes, deteriorate, and go in Jesus' name right now. Tears, I call you forth in Jesus' name. I call tears to these eyes. I thank you, God, for them being released right now in
Amen.
Jesus' name. Thank
Amen.
You. I think this lady's going to be able to cry again. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Father, for your goodness to her. I just ask you right now to expect God's goodness in your life. I expect your goodness, God, tonight for this lady right now in Jesus' name. Say, I receive your miracle.
I receive your miracle.
Jesus' name. Release those right now in the name of Jesus.
Let me tell you who Jan is. I met her at the Navajo Nation last week. Her and her husband is here, Michael. And I invited them to come. Praise God, they came. They represent the Pueblo Nation. Glory to God. And I know that whole nation is going to open up to us for one contact. Yeah, this is the way we're going. We're going to hit all the Indian nations.
Yeah.
Glory to God. I'm telling you, it's been prophesied to us, and we're going to get them one by one by one. It's happening. Thank you, Father. Okay, Dennis.
Right above the heart, because of a heart valve problem with my aorta valve.
Yeah, you get the double whammy, brother.
Thank you, Father. We just call these eyes whole in Jesus' name. I call it, we loose.
Heart's healed, no problem.
I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to see like you'd see perfect in your heart. Thank you, Lord. Father, I just thank you. She wants 20/20 vision. God, I thank you. You have supplied it, God. You say you've given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. So eyes be restored in Jesus' name. It's almost like I'm seeing something in your retina. Kind of dial up, kind of adjust. Right now, in the name of Jesus, be healed. In Jesus' name, right now. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah. Anybody deaf here? Just kidding. That's somebody, that's a real safe thing to ask for. You need a little healing, brother? Just stand right where you're at and we'll shoot that ear. We command that ear to open. I was whispering. No, somebody said you can't have fun with the Holy Ghost. Yes, you can. Praise God. Do you think when Jesus healed somebody, he sit there and cried? Said, "I'm sorry, devil. I'll take it easy on you next time." No. I bet he healed somebody, saw him raised from the dead, went, "Wah! That's my Jesus." He didn't go. No, man. He's a man with emotions. Glory to God. Yes, sir. Yeah, you got something to tell me, honey?
Yes, I haven't been able to see. I just see like a gray mist all the time.
Yeah.
And I couldn't see, and then now I can see clear again.
Come on.
Whoa. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Whoa. Wow. She said she wants everything when she just, I mean, we're just flicking the switches on. They're already in there, so. Glory to God. Wow. Anybody else need anything while we're here? Hallelujah. Somebody can't sleep good. Who's that? Boy, you got, oh, man. Come on, come on. Boy, this is a, hey, you got to have good sleep. The Bible says it gives beloveds rest, sleep. So we're going to go, Dennis, you start on that end. Come on, just line up along here. And, yeah. Ooh, boy. Yeah, this is beautiful. Oh, there it is. Ooh, whoa. You need some sleep. Yes. There it is, honey. There it is, right there. You bet, brother. Yeah. Nice try, brother. That was a big boy. Yeah, that's it. You ready, honey?
Yeah.
Boy, you're going to sleep like a baby. You're going to wake up every 2 hours and cry. No. Oh, yes. This is for my wife. You're welcome. Yes. There it is. You've been asking for wisdom. There it is. Glory to God. You're going to hear me clearer than you ever heard before. Hallelujah. God's always speaking. We just don't have confidence He's speaking. He's speaking. There it is, honey. Yeah. You've been asking God for something else, and here it is. I came right out of the heavenlies. Praise you, Jesus. Boy, God loves us. Yes, Jan, what would you like?
I have a racing weak heart. I need it to
racing
slow down
weak
and be
heart.
Stronger. And my eyes are changing. They're getting weaker, and I need them to be stronger again.
Yeah, brother. This is Jan's husband, Michael. Glory to God. We welcome Michael and Jan here. Hallelujah. God supernaturally brought us together. Man, when I first, I hugged this guy and kissed him. Hallelujah. What do you want, son?
My thing needs to fill him.
This guy, he said he'd been looking all over for a dad. And I walked in his life. Hallelujah. I'm so proud of you, son. This guy's going to Florida. He's going to minister in Florida with signs, wonders, miracles. Going to what tribe down to what nation?
Seminole.
The Seminole Nation. Glory to God. So he wants his tank. He's already in there. It's full, but he just doesn't know it. That's the way you treat your sons. Glory to God. Yeah. Hallelujah. We ready for dinner? Okay, praise God. Anybody else need anything? You can come up here and the rest of you can go eat. What about that? Hallelujah. If you need anything, come on. Dennis and I will be up here. Hallelujah. Boy, you're drunk, honey. How's that feel?